We will now begin the 77th Guam Liberation Day ceremony. It is my honor to introduce the Mayor of Sinihanya and the Vice President of the Mayor's Council of Guam, who will serve as our masters of ceremonies for this morning's event.
Thank you, John. Before we begin today's ceremony, we'd like to recognize those who are present here with us today. Please hold your applause and kindly stand and be recognized if you can. Joining us today, we have the Honorable Lourdes A. Leon Guerrero, Governor of Guam. Attorney Jeffrey Cook, First Gentleman of Guam. The Honorable Joshua F. Tenorio, Lieutenant Governor of Guam. The Honorable Therese Terlahi, Speaker of 36th Guam Legislature. Also joining her, the members of the 36th Guam Legislature. The Honorable F. Philip Carbolito, Chief Justice, Supreme Court of Guam. The Honorable Jesse Alleg, President, Mayor's Council of Guam, Mayor of Petey. Joining him are the members of the Mayor's Council of Guam. The Honorable Benjamin J.F. Cruz, Public Auditor, Office of Public Accountability, former Speaker and former Chief Justice. Also joining us here today, we have the Honorable Michael Cruz, former Lieutenant Governor of Guam, GRMC President and CEO, Colonel, Assistant Adjutant General, Guam Army National Guard, and State Surgeon Cell. Accompanying him is his lovely wife, Jennifer Cruz, former Second Lady of Guam. Also joining us today, we have former senators, former mayors, and former vice mayors. We're honored to have with us the Consul General of Japan, Hagatanya Guam, the Honorable Toshiaki Kayabashi, Consul General, Consul Ikumi Oyama. From the Republic of Korea, the Honorable Kim In-kuk, Head of Mission. From the Federated States of Micronesia, the Honorable Teresa Filipin, Consul General. From the Republic of Palau, the Honorable Adelena Ena Jose. From the Philippines, the Honorable Patrick John Hildago, Consul General. The Honorable Consul from the Taipei Economic and Cultural Office, Director General Paul Chen, Director Stephen Xu, Deputy Director Vincent Liu. Also joining us this morning, we have military leaders from the Guam National Guard, Major General Esther Agigi, the Adjutant General, accompanied by Major General Reginald Neal, Deputy Commanding General, United States Army Pacific National Guard, Command Sergeant Major Celso Leonin, State Command Sergeant Major, accompanied by Mrs. Emery Leonin. From Joint Region Marianas, we have Command Master Chief Nicholas Messina, Captain Galata Rick Kratzer, Dr. Michael Polovich, Executive Director. From the 36th Wing, Brigadier General Jeremy T. Sloan, Commander, and his lovely wife, Lisa Sloan. Colonel Travoyos Simmons, Colonel Richard Goodman. From Marine Corps Base, Camp Blas, Colonel Christopher Bopp, Commanding Officer. Master Sergeant Eugenio Ramirez, Senior Enlisted Officer. Lieutenant Colonel Tate Buns, Operations Officer. Emmy Donald Baldwin, Chief of Staff. From the U.S. Coast Guard Sector Guam, Captain Nicholas Simmons, Commander. Commander Master Chief David Fedison. From Naval Base Guam, Captain Michael Luckett, Commanding Officer, Naval Base Guam, accompanied by his lovely wife, Natasha Luckett. Additionally, from the United States Army Pacific National Guard, Colonel Donald Brown. Also joining us today on the center stage, we have Father Richard Menno Kidd, Pastor, Our Lady of Guadalupe Catholic Church, Santa Rita, Guam. We also have, joining us in the audience, we have cabinet members from the Leon Guerrero Tenorio administration. We also have leadership and members from the Menengan Memorial Foundation, the Guam War Survivors Foundation, the Peace Ring of Guam, Japan, the Governor's COVID-19 Task Force, the State Surgeon Cell, and our honored guests today, all our Guam War Survivors and their families. A nice round of applause for all of them. Thank you. Also joining us is former First Lady Joanne Camacho. To begin our program, please stand for the Bendición by Para y Probetson in Tatauta Inc.
Thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the Guam National Guard Color Guard and the singing of the National Anthem and Guam Hymn by Corporal Sid Rifuya and the Guam Army National Guard 721st Army Band.
Fanogita moru porita nota kantai matunanya gitodu ilukat parai ona parai gloria abi Contrai peligrunaf and sofuham, Zeus proteies land Guam. Contrai peligrunaf and sofuham, Zeus proteies land Guam.
Ini frasi, gini ni mas takilom gi nasoku, imas takilom gi kurasonu, zani mas figu nani nasinyahu, uo frasen maisadzu, parabai prutehi, zanhu defendi, I hinengi, I kutura, I lenguahi, I airi, I hanum zani tanu chamoru. Nirin shoku diretsu gini nasu ustata, esti ua fitma gi hilo I biblia, zanin benderahu I banderan guahan.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. O God, creator of the universe, who extends your paternal concern over every creature and guides the events of history to the goal of salvation, we acknowledge your fatherly love when you break the resistance of mankind, and in a world torn by strife and discord, you make us ready for reconciliation. Renew for us the wonders of your mercy, Lord. Send forth your Spirit, that we may work in the intimacy of hearts, that enemies may begin to dialogue, that adversaries may shake hands, and peoples may encounter one another in harmony. May all commit themselves to the sincere search for true peace, which will extinguish all arguments for charity, which overcomes hatred, for pardon, which disarms revenge. We ask all of this, Lord, as we gather before you on this day of great blessing, through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. To give the opening remarks and the opening and the introduction, please welcome our keynote speaker for today, the Lieutenant Governor of Guam, Joshua F. Tenorio.
Hafaday Taltotano. Hafaday, people of Guam, and most importantly, half a day to our war survivors who are present with here with us today. And I'm going to take my liberty here and recognize the Saina of my Labutu family who's here with us, my Aunt Priscilla Tenorio Tunkup, who is a war survivor herself. Sujus maasi, Mama Pat. To all of the Manumku and our war survivors, thank you so much for making it out here today. You are a treasure for all of us. As we grew up, and those of us that spent some time with our grandparents and our great-grandparents, for those that actually did want to share the wartime experience, they actually preferred to talk about how life was before the war. They seemed to want to talk about the joy and celebration that they had, the peace that they enjoyed, until our island was occupied by enemy forces. It is our responsibility as the sons and daughters of Guam, as all those who have moved to our island to make Guam home, to forever remember the pain, the sacrifice, and the life that our people had to endure and then turned the page in order to lead us into a very thriving community, a very thriving island here, out in the Western Pacific, thousands and thousands of miles away from other lands. It is our duty and our responsibility to teach each other and our children and all those younger about the rich history that the people of Guam, the Chamorro people, have made on this land. And it is also our responsibility to recognize the sacrifices of the sons and daughters of Guam who volunteered their lives, who volunteered their time, who volunteered to sacrifice to maintain our peace and liberty. And so at this time, I would like to ask all of the members serving in the armed forces and all of the veterans who are present here with us to please stand and be recognized. Thank you very much for continuing to serve our island, to serve our country, and to make sure that peace will never again escape this beautiful island of Guam. So ladies and gentlemen, let's consider this, Governor, our 1 year mark. 1 year that we all have to prepare for what I believe is gonna be a very vibrant Liberation Day celebration next year when we celebrate our 78th liberation. So a special challenge to every single mayor out there, every single village, every single agency, we're going to make sure that for all our Manumku that remain here with us next year, we're gonna show them an excellent liberation celebration. I'm looking so forward to that. So ladies and gentlemen, imagine if you will, that you are 9 years old during the war, that you spent 2.5 years hiding, scared, watching your parents and your grandparents live in fear, struggling every day to find food on the table, not only to nourish yourself, but to nourish all those that are weaker than you. Imagine when you're woken up in the middle of the night, all your neighbors are being rounded up, and you're forced to march to a place that you have no idea where you're about to go. Imagine that, a 9-year-old at that time. So ladies and gentlemen, I want to recognize and introduce a very, very gracious and strong woman. She was 9 years old during the liberation of our island. At 9 years old, like many of the survivors here, seeing things that none of us could have imagined seeing, even as adults. So ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to introduce to you our keynote speaker from the village of Asin, and also an auntie of mine, ladies and gentlemen, Cynthia Tenorio Terlahi.
Half a day. My name is Cynthia Tenorio Terlahi, and I'm a survivor of World War II. On the morning of December 8, 1941, the island was invaded by the Japanese forces. 2.5 years later, Uncle Sam came back to Guam to take the land again. We were down in Agana when the bombs started coming down from the airplane, and we didn't know what to do as a child. We didn't know what was going on, so we just have to follow what our parents had told us to do. But what I remember was that when my parents gave us some pillowcases to stuff some what we needed to take, we just do as we were told. And then later on, the bombs started coming down, just scaring and everything, but we don't know what it was. We don't know what war was. So we started walking up. We got up from the house and then started walking up the hill up to Tutuhan, which Sagana has the call right now, and up to Manengun. As we were going up to the hill, somebody else again got hurt, so we have to kind of ducked down because the bomb was still going on. And then we continued going. As we were up there, my parents, they're with four siblings, myself and four siblings. Over time, the bombs were coming again, and we started walking, following all kinds of people, going up towards Manengun in the jungle area. We ended up in Manengun, and then we landed there. We went through the river area where my father started digging a hole for us to get protection from the bombing. Then my parents had gone out looking for something for us to eat. They came with some young breadfruit. They boiled it up. It was very young, but you know, what can we do? So what they did was they boiled, then they started squeezing out the water for us to eat. But I ended up getting sick. I was already malnutrition. And starving, thirsty. And then later on, as we continue living in that Gokongo, I had no idea how long we stayed there. But then I remember when my mother came to me, not saying anything, but she grabbed some kind of cloth and she wrapped me in it. We went outside and I thought they're probably gonna get something else. I remember the last time when she bent down, she gave me a kiss, but I had no idea that they're going out for good. I don't know how long I stayed in that Bokongo all by myself, crying. Until one day, a man came in, asked me, "Who is with you?" And I told him, "I have my family with me." He said, "There's nobody out there. There are people just going and running and everywhere, bombing people, coming down from the sky, machine guns from different directions." I was just thinking to myself, just, gee, 9 years old, sick, and I didn't know what was going on. But anyway, the man says, "I'm not going to leave you here all by yourself. Do not be afraid, because I'm going to take you along with me." So what he did was, he put me on his back, and we went outside. We see he's supposed to left his wife and daughter there. But when we came out, they were going too with the other crowds. So we start walking, you know, in the jungle area. And then somebody mentioned that, you know, we have to go towards the south. We have to, you know, at the Agat, because that's where the military people sat. But then I don't know how long we were out on the road, you know, walking. We're going over dead people. There's just dead bodies all over. And then finally we end up in Agat. And he handed me over to the military and told them to take care of me. Because look at this, she's very sick, she needs help. And that was the last time I saw this man. And then, one day, I believe it was almost 3 days, 2.5 days actually, when I was already feeling better, and I was sitting outside the tent of the little dispensary. And then I saw hundreds and hundreds of people coming out from the jungle area. I was just wondering, you know, I was just, Look at all those people, just talking to myself. Not even thinking about my family or anything. A 9-year-old girl all by herself. And then finally, all of a sudden I saw my sister. And that's when I stood up and I started yelling at her name, you know, and I started waving. Here I am, you know. And then finally she turned around and told my parents, there she is. She's over here. She's over there. And then they all ran up to me. And that was the time when we all got reunited. I had no idea they were, you know, that they would be coming. Actually, they didn't come to see me, but at least I welcomed them. So I was really getting better. And then at that time, we start to live our life again, you know, try to be, to live a normal life again. After the war, we started rebuilding and trying to find some kind of a normalcy. My sibling and I went back to school. And that's when I met my husband, to be, but he's about 5 years older than I am. But then on his senior year, he decided to join the military. So he did, he joined the army. And after that, he was deployed to Korea. And then after the war, he came back. And that's when he proposed, yes, my parents take me in. So that's when we got married, on July 18, 1953. Our first child was born here on the island of Guam. Then we started traveling from station to station around the world. I have 7 other kids born there, carrying with me then. He got deployed again to go fight in the Vietnam War. Then I end up again being mother and father to the children by myself. I don't know whether my husband's gonna come back alive to us, or is he gonna come in box? I just continue praying, you know, that everything will be okay. But there was one thing that never left me, you know, just thinking about the guy, the man that saved my life. We raised our children. We told them to always remain humble and always be grateful for all we had, even if it wasn't. We told them how to farm, to raise their own livestock, and go fishing. And on weekend, that's when we start going fishing with the family. And for some reason, I remember that we've been going up to Zonia every year for the Pidu family, where they had the novena in Santa Maria. So as a fisherman, we always provided the seafood for them. So one day, my siblings and my parents are living back in the mainland, so my mother came to visit. And then when she saw the seafood, and we told her that we are on our way to Zonia, to the Pidu family, to give our contribution for the novena. And then she held my hand and went towards her and told me, when you get up there, ask Pepe Pidu for his son, Francisco, because that's the guy that saved your life. Oh my God, I could hardly walk. That was the first time I heard of that man's name. But I didn't know. I've been going to his house all over 7 years, and I didn't even know that he was the one that saved my life. Until that night, it was just coincidence that when we got up to Zonia, they were all sitting down, each of them was telling the stories, what they experienced during the war. So they told us just to sit down and start listening. My husband was just holding me down. Because the minute I saw, I told him Uncle Frank at that time. As soon as I saw his face, I was ready to go over there and just give him a big hug and kiss, you know, and thank him for saving my life. But my husband, held me down. And he says, not yet. So Uncle Frank just continued with his story. And then he says, before I die, I just want you to know what happened to the girl that I picked up at the Bokon. Whether she's alive, married, off island, she's on the novice, or she have any children. I was shaking. And somebody was telling my husband, what's wrong with your wife? I said, just wait. And then finally after he finished saying his story, I ran to him and I sat on his lap and held his face with my both hands. And I told him to take a good look at his face. Because this face is the one. The little girl that you picked up from that book in Manengun, and this is the one that saved your life. That you saved the life. So I want to thank you so much for saving this. So off we go again. After that, I'm still blessed. I'm still here. I'm a survivor of the war. Today I was fighting. We're all fighting the war, another invisible war, the coronavirus. Last year, the pandemic hit home. I was once again unable to move freely. I had to stay home because of my age. I'm very vulnerable with the disease. I'm pretty much independent. Now I want to rely on my daughter to shop for me, pick up my medication. Even though she's working, it's not like before that we used to have family get together on weekends, have dinner, and you know, just. Besides 9 children that we have too. I'm sorry I had to go back again. I thought, when my husband retired in 1970, October 1970, he came home to celebrate his retirement. And then I thought I was retired too. But then I got pregnant. 9 months later, I gave birth to number 9. So my first one was born here and my last one, so it's gonna bookends, because the other kids were, 2 were born in England, 3 in California, 1 in North Carolina, 1 in France. So I had United Nations babies. That's what's so dry. One year later, I decided to get vaccinated on March 2021. And my daughter and I were even skeptical because of the vaccine developed with such a short period of time. So we take chance. We need to take. I want to say to the people of Guam to go out and get vaccinated, even if it isn't guaranteed 100%. Let's put the solution and getting this coronavirus 19 under control back to normalcy. Get vaccinated. There is nothing to be afraid of. There's so many lives that were gone with this disease. I'm here. I survived World War II, survived typhoons, and all kinds of disaster. So I just want to thank Governor Julian Guerrero, Lieutenant Governor Joss, for allowing me to the privilege to today to speak. I'm humble. And before I close my remarks, I want to thank you all the World War II survivors. Of course, we're the best. We're the best. We're survivors. And God bless our island of Guam and all her people. Viva liberation, Guam. Jesus Masi.
Thank you, Mrs. Serlahi, for sharing your story of courage and faith. I'd now like to invite the Honorable Lourdes A. Leon Guerrero, Magahagan Guahan, Governor of Guam, for her commemorative message.
Jesus Masi Cynthia ni Storiamo Tungana Utungana na Piniti Zutungana Makat Mahasu Hafasaman Bidan Mizu Gi Tempungera Lo Jesus Masi ni Eno Nestoramu Bula Loki Storia Tagiha Asintia Ni Hamzui I war survivors humahasu. Lo Belsunganyamzu na todu historian mizu storia historian mizu adzuha munafen membet good hit. Todizi experience mizu durante nigera. Iman masak bit mizu, iman matrakan mizu, iman matrai dod mizu. Adzu siya na koses, sumisugi mona munafen met good hamzu. Zapudi minet good mizu, inafen met good ham lokwi. Adzu sinya kumun swelu hit antali I bakgu, Hafa ta susesidi gini gita nota. Hunggan besengwanyam zu man lamo likit. Gwas kwilata, gwas pitata, gwa karitata, gwa gumata. Lo mas importante man yasagahit gitempun pas. Za letku na angin tipuri Amerikano ane man holum. Zaman masak bahit, hamzu, mas, benti bula siya man matai mas, kini azisai man matai. Bes, azuha sinyosangan kontra hamzu na periminat gudmizu kontra ipiligru tafanatu. On this day, July 21st, we saw the liberation of our people. We heard cries of joy, of cathartic release, of freedom. Battle cries from men and machines rang forth on our beaches. The smell of sulfur and gunpowder rose into the air, spreading itself over the island, a welcome sign that help was here. Brave and courageous American soldiers landed upon our beaches and charged forward against artillery, shells, and gunfire, weathering through dozens of fellow countrymen dropping around them. They persisted and they changed our destinies. This day marked the beginning of the end of a years-long enemy occupation. No longer would our people be forced to speak a foreign language and forget our native tongue. No longer would our people bow to Japanese soldiers. And no longer would our people live in fear, wondering if today would be their last. For the first time in years, our people could proclaim, "We are Chamorro." 77 years today we carry this history with us. This history lives among us. They are held within our Manamku, whose tenacity, whose bravery, whose faith carried them through the worst of war and enabled them to be with us today. Today, we honor this manana, our greatest generation. We commemorate you and your stories. We reflect on your hardships and suffering. We mourn those whom we've loved and lost. But liberation cannot be achieved without our liberators. We stand here on the efforts of those American soldiers who fought to retake this island. We commemorate their bravery and we honor their sacrifice, risking life and limb to protect others. Our people have a history of survival against all odds. When the Spanish brought disease and discourse from tuberculosis and gunfire, our indigenous population was reduced to 10%. Even still, we survived. When super typhoon winds and rains swallowed our island whole, our people did not falter. Instead, we learned to weather the storm. When destructive, life-threatening earthquakes rumble the ground beneath our feet, our people stood firmly, and we still stand proud today. When COVID-19 threatened lives and livelihoods, we persevered. Rather than surrender to the clutches of the deadly virus, we pushed forward together. Exactly 492 days ago, our island joined the globe in the war against this unprecedented pandemic. Just as December 8, 1941 marked the start of enemy occupation, so will March 15, 2020. While this enemy has no face, it invaded our shores and consumed our lives, taking millions of lives across the globe, and 143 of our own will not walk away from this war unscathed. We mourn these souls and grieve with their families, and we commemorate them with 143 vacant seats on to your left. And while every liberation has its liberators, look around you. Each of you have been soldiers in our fight. You did what needed to be done. You wore your mask, watched your distance, and washed your hands. And when the vaccine became available, you got your shots. You have been our army in this battle. For that, I thank you for helping us to achieve one of the highest vaccination rates in the nation and in the world. Now we lead by example, sharing our vaccine success with others, and doing our part in the global fight. In the coming days, we will have achieved Operation Liberate Guam. When this day comes, life will resume to some sense of normalcy. We will enjoy friends and family without caps and social gatherings, and businesses can resume operations at 100% occupancy with no limits. While I plan to lift these restrictions, our mask mandate will remain in place. Historically, July 21 marked a turning point for Guam, and the same sentiment rings true today. Much like our Manana built Guam, we will do so again. Today, we celebrate liberation. For 77 years, Guam's liberation story has been a story of survival, a story of moving past fear, a story of resilience and recovery, a story of rising against all perils. Concha y peligro, tafanatsu. Viva Guam!
Viva!
Viva Guam!
Viva!
Viva liberation!
Viva!
Sejus ma'asir.
Thank you, Governor Leon Guerrero. Now at this time, we will honor our living survivors, those who have passed, and our armed forces. We will be laying the wreath. I'd now like to invite the dignitaries to the Liberation Monument for the laying of the wreath. When we call your individual groups, you may pay respects at that time. Laying the wreath, Governor Leon Guerrero, First Gentleman Jeffrey Cook, Joshua F. Tenorio, Lieutenant Governor, Speaker and members of the legislature, Chief Justice, Mayor's Council of Guam, the Consular Corps, military leaders and war survivors, please meet at the Liberation Monument. Proceed to the monument. Yeah. Military, you may follow behind them. Laying the wreath is the Governor of Guam, the First Gentleman and Lieutenant Governor of Guam. They will now pay their official respects. Following their prayers, we have the Speaker of the Legislature and members of the Legislature to pay their official respects along with members of the Mayor's Council of Guam. We will now have the Consular Corps pay their official respects. We now ask the members of the military to please pay and render their official respects. And now our war survivors can pay their official respects and offer their prayers. Thank you, war survivors. Please remain standing as the war survivors return to their chairs. To render the rifle volley, We are pleased to have the Anderson Honor Guard. The playing of the taps will be by DC-2 Alton Lewis of the United States Navy Joint Region Marianas. Military members, service members in uniform and veterans, please render the proper hand salute, and civilians in attendance are asked to place your right hand over your heart immediately following the first volley. Please remain standing for the benediction by Polly Richard Menno Kidd.
Ginani Tata, Jani Lahinya, Jani Spiritu Santo, Amen. Ginani Tenazzo de Santa Maria in Cumberland, Puerinis Jus in Fambinidisi, Todo Samzo, Ginanzo Stata, Ilahinya, Jani Spiritu Santo, Amen.
Thank you, Polly Richard. In the beginning of the program, we were supposed to have a flyover, but we want to just mention and thank them so much for trying to make this happen. Unfortunately, the flyover won't take place, but we want to welcome and thank the F-15E Strike Eagles from the 389th Fighter Squadron, Mountain Home Air Force Base, Idaho, the F-22 Raptor from the 525th Fighter Squadron Joint Base, Elmendorf, Richardson, Alaska, and the F-22 Raptor from the 199th Fighter Squadron, 154th Wing, Joint Base, Pearl Harbor, Hickam, Hawaii. If the weather clears up later on today, they will fly over Guam. Their flyer is going to be a tribute to the six airmen that were killed on July 21st, 2008 in a B-52 Stratofortress crash with the call sign Raider 21. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes today's 77th Liberation Day ceremony. On behalf of our Magahaga Lulian Guerrero and Segundo Magalahi Josh Tenorio, thank you for your attendance here today and those who joined us virtually as well.